You see now, cargo boat to Lisbon,
fly from there to Gibraltar, pick up the liner as far as Naples, and there's a wonderful coach ride up to Venice. After that, Bob's your uncle.
A really perfect summer holiday begins in the winter. It may be all right for film stars and millionaires to tell their secretaries 3 days before they want to go to charter a yacht or book the royal suite, and even then they can't always be satisfied at such notice. But for ordinary people, it's not only more sensible, it's more fun to make their plans in the depths of the English winter. That's what this family are doing with their maps and their arguments, of course. The familiar room is filled with deliciously unfamiliar names, poetic names, such as Move the Poet, who said, "Far, far from here, the Adriatic breaks in a warm bay." Already they are wandering in a bright dream of sunshine and strange cities. But how? Where? Ship to this point, rail to that, coach up to here, fly there. Here's another idea.
Why don't we go on a cruise then? It's all fixed up for you and you don't have the bother of hotels.
Cruise? How could the girl? Lucky we're millionaires.
Susan, how do you think we can afford a holiday like that?
It doesn't cost all that money, Mummy. Look here.
And Sea View isn't all that cheap.
Of course, once you pay for a cruise, you pay for the lot. Except for drinks.
And they're cheaper, incidentally.
Think of it. It'd be like stepping out of bed and straight onto the end of the pier every morning.
I must say, do you really think we can afford it? I'm beginning to wonder.
Oh, no, darling, honestly. Sea View is so much less trouble. And we practically promised Mrs. Strudwick we'd be back.
Now, ready, everybody? Heads, Mrs. Strudwick. Tails, the Sunshine and the SS Arcadia.
To any normal person, there is nothing in the world quite so fascinating as a great ship. Ships have always been romantic and adventurous. But when you come to think of it, it's only in the last century that they've been romantic and adventurous and luxurious. It was clever of man to build little wooden things of 70 tons that somehow got across the Atlantic, with the crew eating salt pork and awful old fish. But it's even cleverer to build a great monster of steel in which you have all the services of a first-class hotel, and yet never for one moment the same as a hotel. Underlying everything, there is a sea rhythm, a sea method, a sea tradition. The 30,000-ton Arcadia is one of several giant liners cruising regularly from London or Southampton. Choosing a cruise is rather like choosing a necklace. You decide which ports of call to string on the thread of your voyage. But on a cruise, the thread is beautiful too. Imperceptibly, you slide into change. You are off Cape St. Vincent almost before you realize it. The air gets warmer, the light gets brighter. All cruising liners have a lot of decks. The boat deck, the promenade deck, and a whole lot of just deck decks. But undoubtedly, one of the most popular is the game deck. Meanwhile, serious business is going on downstairs, or below, as we soon learn to say. 8 electric grills, 5 hot presses that hold 6,600 plates. But away with statistics. Look. Why does luxury at sea seem so much more exciting than, well, ordinary luxury? Perhaps it's the contrast. Here you sit enjoying the finest fruits of civilization, and all the time the sea is only a few feet away. The passengers sleep. Watchful eyes and skilled hands guide the ship. Now we are somewhere off Spain, the peninsula, which is the P in the company's name. Passengers can see the art of navigation demonstrated in the ship's lounge nowadays. It's a far cry from those early times when the company's navigational responsibilities included not only sea ships, but a lot of camels or ships of the desert. This was before the Suez Canal, and they had to get their passengers overland to the Red Sea. They also added a new word to the language. Going down the Red Sea, the port cabins in those early steamers were out of the hot afternoon sun, as were the starboard cabins coming back. So the best people, who got the best cabins, stipulated port outward, starboard home. P-O-S-H. Posh. Nowadays, of course, all the cabins are posh, and holiday luxuries like breakfast in bed are a matter of course. In any case, we're not going as far as the Red Sea, although you can go as far as New York and Bermuda on some cruises. We're bound for the Mediterranean. In fact, this is the Mediterranean now. A cruising liner is big enough to have nice, quiet corners, where you can, if you want to, get away from it, or them all. Or you can plunge into the very gay social life. The Arcadia, for instance, carries 661 first class and 611 tourist passengers. That's 1,272 people. And incidentally, a crew of 711 to look after them. There are absolutely bound to be some people you like among 1,272. In fact, there is something about cruising which makes the proportion of people you like higher than it would be among, say, 1,272 people in Oxford Street in the rush hour. In a way, you could say that a ship is a machine to do man swimming for him. But on a cruise, especially when you're under the boundless, blissful Mediterranean sunshine, man still likes to do some of his swimming himself. Now, for the first time, down the gangway into a foreign land. The first of the jewels on our particular necklace is Naples. The original name was Neapolis, which meant new city when the Greeks founded it in the 7th century BC. So, of course, it's hardly new now, but it's as beautiful as it ever was. Time ashore, you can have a trip to Rome, Pompeii, Vesuvius, Amalfi, Sorrento, Capri, or Ischia. We've chosen Pompeii to have a look at the fascinating civilization preserved intact in the lava of the eruption on that fatal day in 75 AD. Ever forgets a first impression. And you can't get a stronger first impression of a place than by coming into it from the sea, walking and riding round it, and of course having one of its meals. You could come back later and stay a fortnight, but you wouldn't erase that first impression. You wouldn't forget the boys diving for money. And so back to the thread of the necklace. The letter grandly, somewhere in the Mediterranean. But sometimes it's difficult to remember what day it is. But as one day slides into another, there's plenty to do. Another pleasure of cruising is the ship-shaped shop ship. The ship-shaped ship shop. Well, that is the ship-shaped shop of the ship, not merely the shop of the ship-shaped ship. A shop ship, ship shop is like one of those village shops where you can buy practically anything. Only, of course, it's smarter than a village shop. More ship-shaped, in fact. Now there's some celebration shopping being done here. In fact, while we're still at sea, someone's birthday is coming up. We've remembered what day that is. And a birthday means special ironing. And of course, special hairdos. The end of a day that was the first day of her life 17 years ago. This day is too important to be just one of the dreamlike procession of days on a cruise. There are clocks, there are calendars, there are reminders of the outside world which we have consulted. It's the same date here as it is at home, in the ordinary time of the workaday world. But this is a new time, a new dimension for a birthday. A happy birthday at sea. Floor you can have in a ship 90 feet wide. Cruise necklace is Dubrovnik, and what a gem it is. How beautiful and how unknown to most British tourists is the whole coastline of Yugoslavia, or Illyria, as Shakespeare called it much more bitterly. This indeed is where the Adriatic breaks in a warm bay. Not far away now, but here. Dubrovnik also had a much prettier name until quite recently, when it was known as Ragusa. With its strong fortifications and its independent people, it escaped domination either by the Turks or by the Venetians. In fact, from the 14th to the 16th century, Ragusa was a great sea trading power, with 2,000 argosies sailing all over the Western world. The word argosy itself is derived from Ragusa. You can walk about the walled part of Dubrovnik in peace, because no cars are allowed inside. So there is a chance to absorb the natural sights and sounds. If you're lucky, you may see the courtyard of the famous rector's palace where there is an orchestral concert or one of the dazzling Yugoslav folk dance displays in its courtyard. Here you are half in Europe and half out of it. For here you are on the edge of the vast world of the Slavs that reaches halfway to China. Of Messina, between Italy and Sicily, we're at home again. A cruise ship has this dual character. Seen at Southampton, it stands for abroad, the Mediterranean. But seen at Dubrovnik or Naples, it's home, full of familiar friends. Last jewel on our particular necklace. Up the broad Tagus to the heart of Lisbon. A town of churches, palaces, gardens, palm trees, music. Places is the beautiful Hieronymo Monastery. After Dubrovnik, there is among the palaces and gardens a familiar feel, a European feel. There are special connections, too, with the company to which Arcadia belongs. In the 1820s, they helped the Royal House of Portugal against rebels. And today, the upper quarters of the company's flag are white and blue, the colors of the Royal House of Portugal. The hardy Portuguese sailors are heirs to the great sea traditions of their country. The explorer, Vasco da Gama, lies buried in Lisbon. To them, the sea means work. But at nearby Estoril, it means fashion and gaiety. The fancy dress ball. There's no anticlimax on a cruise. There's only a lot of sea between us and home now, but the social life of the ship is just working up to its climax. There seem to have been plenty of young men among those 1,272. After the activity, relaxation. A cruise is a combination of both. It's a combination of two other basic opposites, sea and land. Now the opposites are meeting. The ends are drawing together. The necklace is being closed. The gifts, the photographs, the friendships, the lively impressions are being sorted out. But the people who return to Southampton are not the ones who set out. They've been changed. The spin of the coin certainly gave the right decision. Always the necklace will be worn and remembered. And always they will be able to say, I, too, have lived in Arcadia.